Happy Sabbath, everybody. How are we doing today? It's Pastor Stu. So back to be in the church, not sitting in the car, not sitting in the hotel, not sitting in my mama's kitchen, not sitting in the bathroom. We are finally back at church. I do want to let everybody know that we are sad to bury Brother Eric Harper today, and it is with great remorse that we have to do so. But we do trust that the Lord is still in control. We do trust that God is still the King of Kings, and he is still the Lord of Lords. We also trust that in that great getting of morning, when the Lord shall come back and the sky shall roll back like a scroll, that we will be children of God, caught up with Brother Eric in the air, and then we'll be able to rise onto the kingdom that the Lord has preserved for us to return back to this earth. I want to put that back out here. This is not our home as it exists today, but it is our home that just needs to be renovated. And so I want to let everybody know that we are grateful to God that we can return here and be blessed. Now, there's a couple of topics at hand. Number one, I want to encourage everybody to know church is slated to open sometime in June. The time specifically is to be determined. The conference said it will give certain people, certain churches, permission to go back June 20th. We are hoping that we are amongst that number, but responsibly. Hand sanitizer is a must. Lysol is a must. Face mask is a must. And a need for us to have gloves. We need to have gloves to make sure that people, when they touch surfaces, are not infected or pass on an infection. And so we want to make sure that our church is properly equipped there. We also need a thermo-infrared scanner. I've been made known that there may be a group helping churches with packages. And so we want to continue to pray at that end and ask people who are concerned about coming to church, please, ma'am, please, sir, donate to that cause. Donate to that cause. Donate to the combined budget. Give extra $2, $3, whatever you can to make sure that we're able to have church together. I've been getting so many phone calls about how many of us miss church and how many of us miss the opportunity to be in relationship together. And so I want to encourage you guys one more time. Please, ma'am, please, sir, give us an opportunity to be blessed. Let's get into the Word of God real quick today because it'll be short and simple. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, we'll start with verse 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. We'll start with verse 3. Notice what the word of the Lord says. The word of the Lord says this. It said, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction. Focus. So that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For just as the sufferings of Christ are ours in abundance, so also our comfort in abundance through Christ Jesus. But if we, verse 4, are afflicted, it is for you. It is for your comfort and salvation. Or if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which is effective in the patient enduring of the same suffering which we suffered. And our hope is for you. And our hope for you is firmly grounded, knowing that as you are sharers of our sufferings, so are you also sharers of our comfort. Let us pray. Father God, I stretch forth my hands to thee. Lord, there is no other help I know. Lord God, if you would draw your hands from me, Lord, where shall I go? God, we need your help today. Father, riots are breaking out across our nation. Death is creeping across our cities. Feels almost like a civil war. God help. Help us, God. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Amen. Today our sermon title is A Riot, But I'm Still Comforted. A riot, but I'm still comforted. Let's go to work. Paul is a black man sitting in a jail cell. Paul knows he's going to die. Before now, jail has been relevant. His imprisonment has been relevant to almost a shadow version of parole. Paul is followed up until now by a centurion guard to all of his destinations. He's followed and walked behind to where literally everyone sees him and they say, they say, ooh, he's in trouble. But he's still able to go to the marketplace and he's still able to go to the grocery store. He's still able to go to church and he's still able to go to the different places. But everywhere Paul goes, there's a guard that walks with him. And the guard walks with him and determines whether he's gone too far or makes sure that he's not a flight risk and make sure that he doesn't become a threat or continue in his contraband preaching and deliverance of God's word. And notice what happens. Paul still writes gospel letters. Paul still prays for people. Paul still preaches and teaches. Paul still witnesses to people. And notice what happens. Paul is now finally at one of his last letters in the entire Bible, and he's now sitting here grappling with the fact that no longer is to live as Christ and to die as gain a good thing to say. Paul is finally focusing, tantalizing, dancing with the concept of death. And now as he sits here with someone else writing on the other side of a jail cell, Paul has determined within his spirit that literally that he serves a God of mercy and he serves a God of comfort. And that's something I want to drop in y'all's spirit today, is that literally today we serve a God who is merciful enough to protect us from the things that we go through, and we also serve a God who doesn't allow us to endure travel, nor suggest the concept of suffering without the idea that we also still serve a God who will not let us go through things without ration, reason, benefit, profit, or extension, but we serve a God who's intentional in making sure that we are continuously comforted in all of our sufferings, we're comforted in all of our affliction, and we're comforted in all the things that we go through. And here's the thing about it. I was reading the Bible and I noticed that the problem is the word mercy, because when I was reading this immediately and it said God of mercies, I had an issue with it, because at this present moment, Paul is only guilty of living as a Christian. And you got to understand the parallel. We today feel as people of color, or we have observed, if we're of a different descent watching this recording, we have observed that there are people who look differently than us that seem to be unnecessarily persecuted inside of our lives. And here's the part that's interesting. And we have such a parallel with Paul, because he's persecuted for doing and being not just what he was called to do, not what he was just trained to do, but according to his lineage of being from Benjamin, named, circumcised on the eighth day. Paul literally is a person who was born to be a Christian. And notice what happens. His living, not being in vain, but just an existence, causes Paul to be persecuted in a world where pagan is considered not so much the dominant culture, but it is literally considered the lesser culture. In other words, if you are a religion that is smaller inside of a larger context, then you are the pagan. In other words, Paul's living where Greek mythology and gods and ideas are being perpetuated. And so as a result, when there's hurricanes, when there's volcanoes, when there's tornadoes, when there's earthquakes, literally people blame the Christians. Let me see if I can say that again. When there's crime and when there's drug infestation and when there's debt and when there's drama and when there's disrespect and where there's community unrest, they don't blame the people that caused the issue. issue. They don't blame situation and chance and opportunity. They blame the people of color for being the ones that engage in it. And notice this blaming and being on the right side of situations and being the victim to living his life. He is the one that literally becomes afflicted. And so watch what happens in the text. Literally, Paul has noticed that affliction, because he's called by God, made by God, fashioned by God, and a part of the lineage that exists within the bones of David, that also exists within the bones of Jesus Christ. Notice what happens. The Bible says that Paul reckons that comfort and affliction are bedfellows. And that's something that at first you kind of hear and it makes you grimace on the inside. But I would like to engage to you in this ever-present moment that just because you are afflicted and comforted in the same breath, I would like to tell you today that there's a God who moves on your behalf in such a new way. Remember, we just talked about the word mercy, and let me explain it to you. The Bible, in this part of the Bible, when it uses the word mercy, it's not a real accurate translation. The Bible's actually saying God's move toward his bowels turn. Okay, so let me see if I can say this differently. In other words, the text is literally saying, when the people of God are afflicted, literally the Lord has a bowel-turning experience. Okay, let me see if I can say it differently. In other words, literally what's happening is God gets irritable bowel syndrome when his people get hurt. God gets so disturbed that he has an emotional response within himself that conjures up the immediate need for comfort to come in the presence of his people during their affliction. And y'all, let me tell you the truth. At first, this was kind of discouraging, but when I thought about it, I thought to myself over time, man, how cool is God that God doesn't allow for us to suffer anything without being able to be loved by him. Oh man, let me see if I can say that differently. I'm gonna say it one more time and I gotta go, because unfortunately I gotta preach this eulogy for our baby that has passed away. Let me say it like this. In other words, in the text, the Bible's literally telling us that literally when problems come, the immediate turning of God's soul happens to where he doesn't even think about it. He just dispenses mercy. He just dispenses grace. He just dispenses help. He just dispenses comfort. And y'all, let me tell you, when I thought about everything I've ever been through, and when you look back over your life and you think things over, when you think about the things that people have gone crazy for, when you think about the things that people are putting white straitjackets for, when you think about the things that have snuffed people out to kill themselves, when you think about the things that people walk down the same street you walk, and they got hit with the bullet, they got hit with the drop, they got jumped in the street, they got messed up and left. But look, you are still here, and God's allowed you to still make it. And when I look back over my life and I think things over, I can truly say that I've been blessed because I got a testimony. I got a God who feels me. I got a God that bowels turn. I got a God that automatically dispenses and disperses some love on my behalf when I wasn't able to feel the love from nobody else, when I couldn't find out how to love myself. That's what it is, love. You loved. Yeah, you love. You matter so much that God feels you every now and then, and it makes him just automatically excrete mercy just because it caught him off guard, and he loves you so much that it hurts him. Now watch the part, because it's the most important. The problem is that when we see this, we literally think to ourselves, man, the problem is, Lord, why couldn't you stop the affliction when you brought the comfort, God? Why in the world must I be afflicted? And let me explain this to you. Because the reality of it is, we must be afflicted to help those who are impatient. I'm going to say it one more time, and I'm going to get out y'all's way, because I don't want to belabor this moment too long because I don't want to be too emotional and over dramatic with the issues that we're suffering today. I'm still dealing with my own prayer. I'm still dealing with my own frustration. I'm still dealing with my own need to want to hurt. And I'm still dealing with my own need to want to say something. And I'm still dealing with my own need. And I just want to tell y'all right now that literally in the Word of God, the Bible says that literally we get afflicted to help those who are impatient. The Bible says that literally our hope is within the patience of you. Okay, let me see if I can say it again. In other words, what the Word of God is literally saying is that He is calling us to go through it for people on their behalf so that He knows that He's worked with us and He's fine-tuned us to know that we as a group of Christians are more patient than those who don't know Christ, and that our patience and our suffering and our affliction, but also coupled with the bowel-moving comfort of God, literally has a relationship that the Lord allows us to go through primers that cause patience, so that when we get to people that have no patience, we're able to reach out and touch them and keep them from killing themselves. We're able to reach out and touch them and keep them from filing for divorce. We're able to reach out and touch them and not give up on getting out of debt. We're able to reach out and touch them and tell them, baby, if you just keep eating clean, you're going to drop some weight and your knee pain's going to go away and your gout's going to shrivel and the cancer's going to be lesser than it. We are to reach out and touch them, that we are to be able to help them in patience where they would be impatient and normally kill themselves. So watch this. This is the thing, y'all, and this is the last part and I'm done. We are literally, as children of God, not only supposed to be patient, but the Bible also tells us, as children of God, we're also to be sharers. In other words, you can't give patience by causing someone to suffer and just give. You are to share it. Okay, let me see if I can say that differently. In other words, church, we are to be equally as patient and sharers of patience. Okay, I'm gonna say that one more time. We are to be patient and sharers of patience. In other words, the Bible says what the enemy meant for evil, God was able to turn it for good. The Bible says that when, okay, let me see if I can say this different because I don't want nobody to miss this. In other words, the Lord is literally telling us in the Word of God that these things that are coming, that are happening, are about us sharing the patience of God, that God may be able to show people the ignorance of their ways. I'm gonna say it one more time. We don't live in a world anymore where the thin blue line is so thick that they can literally do this. We will not live in this world anymore. God is literally telling us that there are officers and police officers and governments and politicians and community social activists that literally will say something to keep this good old boy club from killing us. And let's not allow ourselves to become like them. Let's not look at one person who's chosen trouble and blame the whole group of people for being trouble. There's one 4 bad cops in that video. Minneapolis police are not all bad. There are a couple of bad cops in every police department. Not all of the police officers are bad. Because unfortunately, the ones that catch the riot are usually the same ones that wouldn't shoot at you. Understand where I'm coming from. I'm angry too. But we are to share the gospel. We have to share the Word of God. And I'm not saying that sometimes disruption doesn't need to happen. I'm not saying that. Too many examples in the Bible where David, children of Israel, were minding their business in the wilderness. And the Amorites, the Amalekites, whoever, came around the backside and hurt women and children while David was out protecting the nation. In the process, God tells David to go back and kill everybody and the animals. I'm not here preaching some phony gospel. I don't believe in that. But this is true. The Lord has called us to be angry and sin not. Lord has caused us much comfort as the world has tried to cause us suffering and affliction. The Lord doesn't care about jobs. He doesn't care about money unless it is to bless the people and elevate them to their God. The Lord only cares about saving his children. That's the part that sets the imbalance. While you're alive, the Bible says in Matthew 18, stumbling blocks will come. While we're here, nothing in this scripture ever gives us the concept that God's comfort will be greater than our affliction. The only thing here, in this specific scripture that the word gives us, is that literally, God will save us. And I don't just believe in an eternal salvation. I believe in a physical one too. So here's my word. Why won't we be sharers of the salvation God has given us? Why don't we become partakers and sharers of the gospel he's extended? Why won't we become partakers and sharers of patience? Why won't we become sharers of the burden to vote? Why don't we become sharers of the burden to employ as much as the burden to work? Why don't we become sharers in the gospel that saves God's people from the sins of this world? Let this be this comfort that you gave. Let this be the love that we share. For 2 Corinthians chapter 4 says, all these things happen, cast down, not in despair. God's got us. God will continue to have us. God has not given up on us. And we should not give up on God. Let us pray. Father God, I thank you so much for this day. God, I thank you for this engagement that you've given us, Lord, in your word. Lord, I ask right now in Jesus' name, God, that you would continue to be able to touch us, bless us, love us. God, and I ask last but not least, Father, that you would be able to witness to anybody who's on your word right now, God, and I ask that you would please, Father, within your spirit, within your will, within your power, God, please comfort those, dear Lord, who feel discomforted, dear Lord. And I ask that today would be the first day of their salvation, God, not one that is metaphysical for eternal, but God, one that is here today, God, that we can shout and praise, God, not consider it to luck and chance, not consider it to our wisdom and smarts, God, that we made it home safely tonight, God, that we were able to make it, dear Lord, that the wrong cop didn't pull us over, God, but the right guy saw us when we were slightly doing wrong, God, and showed us mercy and grace and favor and provision and love, and God, that he did his job, God, and helped us deal with just the fine of our infraction, dear Lord, not the jail time, the abuse, nor the mistreatment, dear Lord, of what we're going through. God, I ask right now in Jesus' name, Father, that you would please be with every cop, every person, dear Lord, allow for every civilian and every police officer, God, allow for them to be in harmony, God, and allow for us to continue to be adjusted, dear Lord, to where they are protecting and serving, dear Lord, and we are propelling and living, God. I ask right now, Jesus, in your name, in your most precious Holy Spirit, God, that you would please allow for us to see your comfort and allow for us to accept the fact that we mean so much to you that we cause an emotional response by you about how much you just love us. Thank you, God, for loving us. Thank you for being our friend, and thank you for being the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords who sits high on the throne. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Love you. Come see me at the Hill. We're looking at June 20th. God bless.